My detail. My name is Vishal Basist. I'm a PhD student in Adam Mickiewicz University in Poland, and I work in Faculty of Physics. And my main supervisor is Professor Maciej Grabczyk, and my co-supervisor is Dr. Andrew Severinko. And my PhD thesis topic is design and fabrication of ultra-thin nanophotonics devices based on metal surface. Before I go into the technical detail, I just want to give you a motivation why I decided to work in this area. Looks like nature is really beautiful. And the one key reason for this is we have colors. And the color exists in nature. So it turns out that there are two mechanisms which is used by the nature at the same time in order to generate these colors. And these two mechanisms is pigment-based color, and the second one is nanostructure-based color. Let me just simplify them for you. If you take the feathers of this red bird and you crush them in the form of the powder, this powder looks red, which kind of makes sense. And this color is because of the pigmentation of pigmentation that exists in the feathers of this red bird. But if you take this blue bird and you do the same, you crush the feathers of this blue bird and you make in the form of the powder, it doesn't look blue anymore. So what's going on? Why it doesn't look blue? And the reason is this color is not because of the pigmentation. This color comes from the nanostructure which are on the surface of this bird. So this is because of the periodic arrangement of this nanostructure which exists on the feathers of this bird, and because of that we have this kind of specific color. From the scattering theory, one can easily calculate that what wavelength will be reflected that depends upon the size, shape, and the periodic arrangement of these nanostructures. But one thing if you notice here is that these three-dimensional nanostructures, they are really, really complicated. So it's kind of hard to replicate them, but this is exist in nature, and nature is so beautiful that it can easily manage this. So here is the important thing. Can we learn something from nature and try to replicate these kind of natural colors? And I'm an electrical engineer. I did my master's in engineering, bachelor also in engineering, and I decided to learn something from the nature and try to replicate this kind of color, natural color. And that is my motivation to work in this direction. And in order to answer the question that can we replicate this or not, I want to introduce a term, something called optical nano antenna. So look at this piece of yellow piece of metal. So if you have a piece of metal, then actually it is scatter the light. And the scattering depends upon the length. So what wavelength will be scattered, that depends upon this length only. So this is scatter will have an amplitude profile, and this also has a phase profile. And the scattering peak will come depending upon what is the exact length. So this is related to this this relationship, L equal to lambda by 2. So for example, if you want to scatter something in visible range, that means the wavelength goes to 400 to 700 nanometer, then the length should be two times of that that wavelength, and that will scatter the light in visible range. Most important part, if you change the scattering size, so basically the amplitude response also shifted on frequency scale, also the same happened with the phase scale. This is the property of this optical nano antenna. So because the dimensions are in nanoscale, so I'm calling them as a nano antenna. Some people call them nanostructure, but these are like similar things. You can make this kind of nano antenna with using disk shape. You can make them disk shape, you can make them tablet form, you can make them V-shape or U-shape, whatever you like. And any surface which is filled with this kind of nano antenna, that surface we call as a meta surface. So meta means something beyond. So this is a surface which is actually arranged with this nano antenna in a systematic fashion in order to achieve certain functionality. So we call this surface as a meta surface. You can make this nano antenna either metallic or you can make them as a dielectric also. It turns out that at optical frequencies, metallic nano antenna are very lossy. So it is recommended to use all dielectric nano antenna approach in order to counter the losses problem. Here's a good example for structural colors. This is the Leica disc from 4th century. And people in 4th century, without even knowing the physics, they arranged this nanostructure on this glass, on top of the glass surface. So these are basically aluminum and gold nanostructure. And they are arranged in such a manner that when the light strikes from the outside, this glass looks green. But when the light strikes from inside, this grass look red. Quite interesting. Probably, I'm not sure people know the physics on that time. But recently, from 2000 onward, there's a lot of research going in this direction in order to produce this nanostructural based color filter. So this is a group from Karthik Kumar from Singapore. And they published this work as a kind of interesting work that this is a silicon substrate. And on top of that, they have this back reflector. So this is a metallic reflector. And there they deposited this nano antenna. So this is made of the golds and silver. So these are a combination of gold and silver. They have this nano antenna on this back reflector. And most interestingly, if you select one periodicity, let's say G equal to some value, and then you sweep the diameter. So you sweep the diameter from 50 to 140 nanometer, then this reflects certain light, and that reflectance spectra change from lower visible spectrum to upper visible spectrum. And in fact, each reflectance spectra corresponds to one color. So basically, if you change it from 50 to 40 nanometer, then you will see a series of colors from here to here. Now, you can do one more thing. You can sweep this periodicity also. So if you change the periodicity and then again you sweep this dimension from 50 to 140 nanometer, you will see this another color. And you can keep sweeping between G and T, then you will see this kind of 2D matrix. So they created this kind of color matrix, and they saw that this color can be produced with the help of this nano antenna. And finally, they arranged this nano antenna in a systematic manner so that it shows this kind of Lisa painting pattern. This is probably, this is the painting which is having a resolution which is very close to a diffraction limit. There is some other groups which also contributed in a similar direction. So this is the group from D2, Denmark Technical University. They also use the similar kind of approach. So they have a metallic nano antenna which is covered with some kind of the polymer. And then again, they use the same concept for making this kind of paintings. This is another group from Australian National University. They use the ferrofluorate resonator antenna approach, but the same thing, this antenna is made of the aluminum only, and then they also demonstrated the color patterns. This is another group, this is from Stanford, and this is another group. They also use more or less similar kind of approach, but the one thing which is common that these antenna are made of the metals only. So here I want to point it out a few problems. First of all, metallic nano antenna, they exit plasmon resonance. So they are very good in reflection mode. So if you want to make a device which operates in a reflection mode, then metals are best. But they're not suitable to make a device in transmission mode, because when the light passes through from this metal, a lot of amount of light is either scattered in a random direction, as well as also some amount of energy is sucked by the metal nanostructure itself. And they are extremely lossy, especially at optical frequency range. Another important part, these metals are expensive. They are gold, silver, aluminum. If you want to make, let's say, a few micron, few millimeter kind of devices, then you will utilize a lot of gold and aluminum. And these are quite expensive materials. And another important point is that we talk about the silicon photonics industries nowadays. So everything is made of the silicon, and it's all CMOS devices are based on silicon only. So it's kind of difficult to fabricate these metallic devices with the silicon photonics industry. And they could have some significant environmental impact also. So then we decided to make something which is like a natural material and more like an old electric nano antenna approach, so that we can counter these losses somehow, so there should not be any losses that should be taken into account. So here is my approach. What we decided to make all dielectric nano antenna array. So here's a unit cell structure. One has to understand this part. So this is a silica substrate. So it's a glass basically. And on top of the blue region, this is a glass substrate. And on top of silica or glass is same thing actually. So on top of that, we have this silicon cross-shaped silicon nano antenna. Now remember that silicon is behaved like a dielectric in optical frequency range. So it's no longer a semiconductor, but it's almost dielectric in a semiconductor range. So this almost lossless device. Of course, in a lower visible range, there is a small losses, but it's still is almost kind of dielectric device. And then we fill this cross-shaped nano antenna in this whole surface. So we call this as a meta surface. So this is a cross-shaped nano filled with cross-shaped nano antenna. This is a meta surface. Now, in order to realize that which color will be reflected, we have to do some calculation. So we did the calculation of length, width, and periodicity using FDTD, numerical FDTD solver. So we calculated the length, width, and periodicity, and we created this kind of matrix for different colors. And now we know that which color will be reflected because we know the dimensions. So this is the simulation that we performed, and we got these dimensions value. Finally, we decided to fabricate our device. So we developed this fabrication process flow at IIT Bombay in collaboration with IIT Bombay, India. And actually, I don't have time to discuss the whole process. Of course, this was the most time-consuming part, but now I I have to just summarize this, that you will end up, at the end, you need a device which is a quartz substrate, and on top of that, you need silicon nano antenna. So you will end up with this final device. This was the whole fabrication process through that we developed at IIT Bombay. And then we tried to characterize this device. So we also first test the dimension. What are the dimensions of this cross-shaped nano antenna? And we realized that the dimensions are pretty close compared to our simulation. So we are able to get some device. Then we did the first level characterization of this device. So we put this sample under optical microscope, and we immediately see this kind of the red colors. So we are able to see these colors under optical microscope in reflection mode. So here's a kind of summary of my work. So we decided to make it in a more systematic manner. So we make this bare pattern of RGB kind of pixel painting. So it's a kind of a small painting, which is RGB painting. So these are the primary colors, RGB. So that's why we focus on these primary colors only. And each of this region is filled with a different size of this antenna. So for example, blue, this is filled with this size antenna. If you take green, this is a different size antenna, and so on. We also did the measurement for the reflectance spectra in order to check the result with simulation result and the measurement result, and there looks there is a reasonable agreement between the simulation result and experimental result. Most important part about the quality of these colors, so we plotted this on CIA chart, and let me just quickly explain you about CIA chart. So the edges decide the saturation of this color. If you reach to the edges towards the edge size, that means this is the highly saturated color. So if you see compared with respect to metal, I do not have comparison, but generally they lie in a very center region. But with the dielectric, you can actually achieve a very corners of the CIA chart. That means the quality of the colors is really, really good. So this was my first article in ACS Photonics in 2017. And then we further try to extend this work. So we want to make tunable color filter device. Let me just give you a quick view that, okay, once you fabricate this device, so you illuminate with the white light source, and this is the color what you see in reflection mode. But the point is, if you illuminate with the white light, the structure size is fixed, there is no mechanism by which you can tune this color. So we want to change this color. Somehow we can tune this color. And here's the approach that we use. So we use asymmetric nano antenna approach in order to design this tunable color filter. So here's the schematic. These are basically, if you notice here very carefully, that the dimension of the horizontal nano antenna is not the same as the vertical nano antenna. And why we use this, actually we want to use the polarization tunable source. So you have a white light source, and which is polarization tunable. So let's say if you select a light which is having only horizontal polarization. So if you select the light which is having horizontal polarization, that means that light is only aligned with horizontal nano antenna. So the horizontal nano antenna is in excitation mode, and because of that, we have certain reflectance spectra here at phi equal to zero. Now, if you change the reflectance spectra from phi equal to zero to phi equal to 90, then only this vertical antenna is in excitation mode, and that corresponds to another reflectance spectra. And remember that each reflectance spectra corresponds to one kind of the color. So basically, we are able to see this. Basically, you will be able to see different colors when you change the polarization from 0 to 90 degrees. Here, one thing which is very important to mention here, that these are basically silicon nano antenna, and these are high refractive index nano antenna, which means that the energy will be highly confined in each of the dimensions only, and it is, and that is the reason this, even this structure is connected, but it's almost behave like an independent nano structure. So we did the characterization of this device in reflection mode, and we took the two samples for the two different dimensions. And when you change the polarization from 0 to 90 degrees slowly, we are able to achieve all of the primary colors from red to green, and for the second sample from green to blue. But not only in reflection mode, we also tested this device in transmission mode, because this is also one of our main aim, that the device should all be able to also operate in a transmission mode. So we also did the characterization of this device, two samples of the device in transmission mode. And when you change the polarization from 0 to 90 degree, basically we are able to get this primary color, another form of the primary color, which is called cyan to magenta and magenta to yellow. So we got all of these colors. So this was my second article in Scientific Report in back 2017, but it's published in 2018 actually. Finally, we decided to extend this work even more. So we want to make, actually we know that if you want to make any kind of display devices, then you need kind of like a, some kind of tunability. So you should be able to, like source polarization is one approach, but can we do something more? So we want to make something like electrically tunable color filter devices. And you could one can work in the same direction by making thermally tunable devices also. And here's the approach, what we decided to do. So if you look this structure, so this is aluminum grating meta surface. So you have this aluminum grating, and we sandwich this aluminum grating within this liquid crystal. So this is the liquid crystal that you have, and this is the back plate, and this is the main part of this liquid crystal. Now, liquid crystal have a special properties that when the light pass through from the liquid crystal, it actually changes the polarization of the light. So if the light is T polarized, then it goes to either TM polarized light. But if you apply the voltage across a liquid crystal, then all of these molecules are aligned along the axis, so there is no change in polarization. The polarization will be the same. Now, what we did, first we fabricate this bare pattern of this aluminum grating structure. So we have this aluminum grating structure, and we know that gratings gives you two different spectrum when you have electric field which is perpendicular to these gratings and another is parallel to this grating. So we did the characterization of this grating in TM mode as well as in TE mode. We tune the periodicity also, one can actually play with the bit also, and we actually make a device for three different periodicity, and we did a characterization in TM, TE mode, and we are able to see that reflectance spectra is changing. So, and that basically means we have a different colors here in TM and TE mode. Now, we don't want to change the source polarization. We want to use the liquid crystal. That liquid crystal will do this job for us. So when you integrate this aluminum grating meta surface with a liquid crystal and you apply the voltage across this, what happened? The reflectance spectra switch. So it changed. So when you apply the voltage from 0 to 4 volt, then we are able to change this color from this to this. In fact, we also got a range of active tuning of this color. So one can see that actually up to 2 volt, a device is almost saturated. But then you start slowly increasing the voltage, then the molecular alignment start taking place and the color start changing. So we are able to see this kind of colors. We did the characterization for the two different devices where we have periodicity of 300 nanometer and 400 nanometer, and we are able to see this active color tuning. So this was the article that we published with NCTU Taiwan University. There is some more relevant work which I want to discuss, but a little bit far from the color filter. So this is related to the photonic crystal waveguide, and the photonic crystal waveguide principle is very well known that if you have a photonics waveguide, then if you want to guide the light in a spectrum, in a specific region, then you create basically defects. And the defects are basically either you remove certain rows or you basically increase or decrease the dimension of certain rows. And that reason is called defect reason, and light travel only in this defect reason, which is a basic principle how the all photonic crystal waveguide work. But here, most important part, we don't want to create defects where we remove certain things or something like that. We want to utilize the surface impedance approach. So we just want to modify a thin layer of the surface. We call this surface, we want to modify only the surface of this photonic crystal waveguide in order to guide the light in this specific region. So first we study this unit cell structure. So this is a silicon in the center, and on top of that we have this two metallic cap. And once you study the Venn diagram of this unit cell, you will see that you will have this kind of Venn diagram, and you can have this frequency spectrum. Now, when you remove this metallic cap from one side, then you see that you will be able to get this kind of defect region. So this is a defect region. And we certainly, in this case, we found the two different modes here. And these modes are something like this. For example, if you remove the center row, cap of the center row, and when you select this mode, when the light goes through this mode, this is basically a mode where the energy is confined within the silicon disk only. So basically it's self-confined in the silicon disk, so it's passed to every next silicon disk. And when it found this direction, it again goes to this direction as well as this direction also. But in the second mode, when you take this mode, this is a chain-like mode that exists in this silicon disk. So this disk, because these are chained like modes, so they don't transfer any energy into orthogonal direction. So the whole light passes through from here to here, and it just goes only in a straight direction. So this was the work that we published in Optics Letter in 2019, even in the later 2019 actually. So this is all about my research work, but now I just want to give a potential impact of my research work in which area it can really impact that. So let me just give you an introduction that, okay, how a normal devices work. So this is like a normal conventional camera pixel. So there's a detector. This is a basically detector. They are nothing but photodiodes. So they are basically photodiodes. So like a CMOS photodiode, which can have each of them is like 20 nanometers. So you can even fabricate very close to like 20 nanometer kind of the photo detector, which are pretty close to each other. But when you want to make a color pixel, RGB pixel, so on top of that, you place basically this dye. So you see, this is a dye. So this absorbs the light. So for example, when the light passes through from this region, the only red light goes to a bunch of detectors, and that is detected by this detector. And then if this light passes through from the green, then only green light is detected. And this is how you make one pixel. So because RGB, you combine them and you make one pixel. Now the important part, which I want to mention, that this is the conventional camera pixel, that how it make. This dye thickness is around 2 microns. So this dye which you use this is basically filter, and that is made of the dye, and this dye is around 2 micron thick. So this is extremely thick device. If you replace this dye with my color filter, what happen? You will be able to basically fabricate the color filter exactly on top of the CMOS devices. So this is 2 micron, and then you replace it by, let's say, 200 nanometer or 100 nanometer kind of the size of the color filter, then you can significantly reduce this almost by 100 times. So then you can make an ultra compact display devices. Second important thing, the resolution of the device, for example, current resolution of a display device is around 5 micron. I guess if I'm not wrong, Samsung has recently reached to 2 micron. And this resolution is not limited by the photo detector, because photo detector, you can fabricate the CMOS photo detector with even, let's say, 20 nanometer size. But the resolution is limited by this dye. This requires certain area, so the light pass through from the certain area and the light should be absorbed, and the certain color of the lights would be observed. So this is the area that actually limit your resolution. If you replace this with a 200 nanometer antenna size, which is we have like a color filter, on that case, you can achieve a resolution which is very close to a diffraction limit. Other than that, I want to point out that you can make natural paintings, which are made of this silicon nano antenna. Even you can use some other natural materials. So you can fill a certain region with a systematic arrangement of this nano antenna. And once the white light strike on this painting, then it gives you this kind of nice colors. So one can make these kind of permanent and everlasting painting, which is made of the natural material, and that is completely degradable over time, and it does not impact in your environment also. And in fact, who knows, one day we can create some kind of the color which even does not exist in nature, because now we know how to make them color, but we can make some kind of new color, and I will call them meta colors. So in summary, in this thesis, what I did, basically I designed and simulated and fabricated the all dilated nano antenna based color filter devices. I also demonstrated the polarization tunable and electrically tunable color filter devices. And I also propose a photonic crystal waveguide, where the modes of the photonic crystal waveguide can be changed by just modifying the surface property of the photonic crystal waveguide. So here's a series of articles which I published during my PhD only. So these are some 4 or 5 articles which I published in my PhD. I was hired under this Opus grant by Professor Maciej Krawczyk and Dr. Andriy Severinko. So this was the grant under which I was hired, but then I have applied for my own grants, Pluritium 16, and I got another grant to the 6. And in fact, I got another grant from University Youthra program. So this was another grant which is from University Youthra program. I worked with several university. Last year, I was at University of Washington, Seattle. And in 2017, I was working with NCTU Taiwan University under Elite Internship program. I also got opportunity to visit Spain in a summer school for 2 weeks. It was also fully funded by summer school. And finally, I got a postdoc position, so I moved to Finland. Currently, I am in Finland only. And it's kind of unjustified to acknowledge everyone. And if I could not, then it will be really bad. So I want to acknowledge few of the people at least, and especially my supervisor, Professor Maciej Krawczyk, and my co-supervisor, Dr. Andriy Severinko, who gave me opportunity to work on his project. He was my co-supervisor, and this is Professor Maciej Krawczyk. So he gave me opportunity to work on this nice project, and I was able to do my great research with him. And his team is really great. It's really hard to take all of the name, but I hope that the guys will understand this problem. And I want to mention Professor Nicolas Bonnet from CNRS France, who actually helped me to write my first article in ACS. I'm also thankful to Professor KP Chen and his whole team. It was really great time in Taiwan in 2017. And last year I worked with Professor Arka Majumdar. I'm still in contact with him. I'm still doing some research with him also. His team was really great. I really enjoy his team also. And finally, last but not least, I started working with Professor Ravi Hegde in IIT Gandhinagar, India, and especially in this area of metasurface design. So I'm really thankful to Professor Ravi Hegde also, who gave me opportunity to work in his group. And here's my past colleagues, Krupali, and this Anurag and other people, Gayatri, Hitesh. This was from IIT Bombay. So we did some fabrication work. This was all team from IIT Bombay. And I'm really thankful for the funding agency who also give me a fund in order to do my research and manage my financial situation. So thankful to National Science Center and University Yotra program who also give me up research fundings. And with this, I would like to close. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for your very interesting.